Hi, I'm Ron Borland.
And I'm Tinker Vanek.
And we're here at Freedom High School today in Oakley. This is a new high school for Oakley. It'll be opening up in January 1997. We've got the principal, the assistant principal, the athletic director for the new school here today. And we've got some other prizes, surprises as well. Tinker, why don't you bring on our first surprise?
Okay, our first guest today is the music teacher, Bill. Can you join us? Welcome, Bill. Bill, he was teaching, has joined us from Cupertino High School prior to coming to Freedom. He came to Freedom excited about the opportunity of designing and building a strong music program for our new school here at Freedom. Bill, tell us about your background a little.
Well, I got my music degree at San Jose State and went to, actually it was Cupertino Junior High School.
Oh, Junior High School,
and
sorry.
And I taught there for 8 years and then moved on here to Freedom High School, and I get a chance to teach high school, and I'm really excited about it.
Great, and to start and build a brand new music school for us, so thank you. What types of bands do you have at Freedom?
Well, we have a concert band and a jazz band, and then I also teach a concert choir, and we also have an instrumental studies class, which is predominantly guitars and bass guitars and drums and stuff like that, rock and roll.
Great. Yeah. So what band is joining us today?
This is the jazz band.
And how many people are in the jazz band?
We have about 20.
Yeah, about 20.
Yeah,
okay, and you can see them right behind us. And you have a concert band. Do you plan on doing a concert here in the area?
Yeah, we're going to have an all-music concert on December 12th at the PAC, Performing Arts Center, over at Liberty High School campus. And that's going to feature the jazz band here and the concert band and also the concert choir.
Oh, wonderful. That's exciting and something for us to look forward to. And what song is the jazz band going to be playing for us today?
The jazz band today is going to play Power Trip.
Power Trip. Well, thank you for joining us, and we will hear them play Power Trip for us.
Great. We'd like to thank Bill and the jazz band for showing up today, doing such a great job. Now we're back with
another guest we're having today. This is Susan Warren. Susan is the faculty advisor for the cheerleading squad here at Freedom High School. Susan, why don't you tell us a little bit about what the cheerleading squad will be doing?
Well, right now they are practicing 4 days a week for the football games. And I think in the middle of November they'll be cheering for basketball games.
What kind of practice do they do? Do they practice a lot?
4 days a week, hour and a half every day after school, pretty much. And if we miss a day of practice during the week, we usually get together on the weekends. These girls work really hard.
Okay. Well, without further ado, let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, the Freedom High School Cheerleading Squad.
The next 30 seconds are going to blow your mind.
Principal and Vice Principal at Freedom High in just a moment.
Hi, we're live here on campus at Freedom High, and I have with me Judy, the Principal for Freedom High, and also Bryce Custodio, the Vice Principal. Welcome both of you.
Thank you.
This is Oakley. Bryce, can you tell us, where are we standing right now?
I'm Judy. We're standing on the courtyard of Freedom High School, and behind us are the three house buildings where students will be clumped in clusters. There's going to be a fourth one that's in a space that's not built yet, then won't be built until phase three. Mm-hmm. But these house buildings will house an administrator, a counselor, and an entire house full of students. And the teachers and the students will all stay together for their core program in the freshman and sophomore years.
Oh, that's wonderful. And I understand that we're standing right here, and there's going to be, the mascot is going to be placed where now?
It's going to be a mascot that's going to be sandblasted and drawn right in the center of the courtyard. There's a circle there.
And the mascot
in the amphitheater. It's the Falcons.
The Falcons.
And there'll be a nice falcon head right there. And then the building just beyond will be Bryce Custodio as the administrator, with two groups of freshmen, two communities with four teachers in each community, and the two houses of freshmen. Right behind you will be a counselor when we start out, with one group of freshmen, four teachers and the freshmen. And behind me, I will open in this building as the administrator with my office right there, and I will have all of the sophomores and the sophomore teachers. Again, two communities, that's eight teachers.
Great. And also, could you tell us a little bit about the open vision that you've been working on?
To start with, the community had a lot to do with developing the division, because they had to have the vision of what the educational program was going to look like before they could put together and design the architecture of the school. So the architecture and the way the school is laid out has a lot to do with the vision. They wanted students grouped in freshmen and sophomore houses, where with a group of teachers, where students, kind of like a smaller school within a school, and that the teachers and the students in one building would all really get to know one another. A teacher would have an advisor. There'll be four teachers working with a group of freshmen, the math, science, English, and social science teacher, and then they'll take their electives, and that could be in any building. But those teachers and those students stay together. They try to relate the program as much as they can. They try to do interdisciplinary curriculum so that things tie together. This is our goal. And we want to have some projects that students understand how the math, the science, and the English and the social science tie into real world activities and how they're used to construct projects and to do work so that the academics are not so isolated from real world work. The freshmen and sophomores will also have lots of activities and after school things, just as in a regular school, and we have a student government. All of that will be here as it is in other schools. But the structure with the freshmen is so that they can have more personalized education. Each teacher has a group of students as an advisor. And the advisory is for many different things. That is to have students learn things they don't ordinarily learn in classrooms that we're learning that they need to know about, such as how to negotiate, how to work in groups, how to put things together.
Sounds like the real world, you know,
right.
That's
what we're trying to do, so that they're not so surprised, and we know that we're going to have technology all integrated into the curriculum. There'll be a computer, small mini computer lab in each of the buildings. There'll be computers in the classrooms. Of course, we're building those as the years go on. We won't have them all in there immediately. The science labs are equipped to have a computer at every workstation coming out from monitor arms. So the students will be doing a lot of their work on the computers because we know that that is the future that we're going into. We also know that we're in the age of information, so students need to know how to gather information, how to use it, how to produce, and that they are the ones that really need to know how to put, how to investigate knowledge and put the work together, because all of the brain research is also showing us that the need for students to learn and to know how to learn is there as the information changes very, very rapidly. They need to know how to gather it. They need to know how to use it. And the teacher just telling them is no longer going to work.
Right.
They have to be the worker themselves.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a wonderful way to go, positive way to teach the children. And you have the freshmen and sophomore houses. Mm-hmm. And then how do you bring in to for the next year? Do you add it each year another?
Yes,
juniors and seniors.
Yes,
they become juniors and seniors.
What we're planning right now, we have a grant from the Walter S. Johnson Foundation to do this. We are planning our academies, and there'll be more buildings that'll be built out around these that are for the academies. Mm-hmm. The first two that we are starting with is a math and science engineering academy, and a child development recreation
sports physiology.
Health Fitness Academy.
Right.
Okay. So those two academies are being planned right now, and our current sophomores will select from one of those. Their curriculum will center around those types of careers, not meaning that that's what they're going into, but that in order to focus their math, science, English, and social science on something real world and to provide some electives in that area,
right,
we want to have an area to focus on so we deal with real world problems.
So how do you feel, when do you feel that this will be completed here?
The buildings?
Yes.
Well, we have the contractor's guarantee that it was going to be completed in January, and we were going to be completed by the December break. However, looking at the buildings and knowing what's going on out here, it could be a little longer. So we're preparing. I've ordered the furniture. We've got the technology ordered, and we've got agreements where we're going to put it if we don't get this building ready for us to move in December for the January opening. We're going to move as quickly as we can after that.
So you're looking at January possibly being open.
Possibly, maybe. February.
And right now, the freshmen and sophomores are at Liberty, sharing campus there.
Yes, we are.
Right. Yeah. Well, this sounds exciting. Now I'd like to talk to Bryce Custodio. Bryce, what are some of the guidelines and policies for Freedom?
Well, a great deal of the guidelines and the policies for Freedom High School and what we're trying to create and develop with the culture and the community of the school is to really involve the students and the parents and the community in the decisions of what happens in the school. Mm-hmm. We had starting places when we first opened. We had to start someplace, so we have a slate of the common sort of rules and guidelines and policies that students and staff, etc., had to follow. Mm-hmm. And from that, what we're trying to do is put into place a system where the students can make some decisions about what the rules are. Mm-hmm. So we've set up a system of an issue referral process that students can actually do some research as to why rules exist, or do some research as into other new things that they'd like to see happen at the school, and put that issue and that process in place, and then we go through a Freedom Leadership Team process that we have with some meetings and those kinds of forums with students and staff to discuss different issues that come up. So I know that it's been real difficult for the students, starting off. We do have a no hat policy, and of course, the schools and districts statewide are establishing various dress code policies because of safety issues, etc. And we're also looking at the ideas of we want to prepare the students for the future and to get out into the work world, and that they need to look nice and dress nice and make learning their focus for their existence in the school community.
Yeah. They have some involvement in this decision making and making it a positive.
Exactly. Yeah. We're trying to work through the advisory mm-hmm. process to make these kinds of decisions happen and these kinds of dialogues go on.
Right.
So the students are constantly involved in dialoguing with staff members mm-hmm. to get their ideas and their feedback, and they're in the process of going through these long drawn out sorts of having to dialogue and compromise, and I think that's important for students to learn that's part of what we all do as adults and in the real world too, is we all have to work together to make things work for the system, so to speak.
That's right.
Yeah.
Are they having any problems as far as going through the guidelines and changing it or accepting it?
Actually,
you mentioned the hat or something.
Pretty much the hat situations come up, but as a whole, in following the rules, and we're trying to build respect and regard for
right.
each other.
Absolutely.
We're trying to build responsibility. Mm-hmm. We've had some just fabulous things happen with the students, and we have an incredible group of students, just a wonderful starting group that have really shown us some responsibility and some support, and really getting actively involved in the school, and I'm really hoping to see that culture grow as we continue with the development in the next few years.
Well, great. Well, thank you. It sounds like a positive environment. I'd like to ask Judy one more question. What can the community do for Freedom?
Well, for Freedom and with Freedom. Freedom is really built as a community school. We want the community as involved as we possibly can get them. Of course, on the fundraising issue, we're trying to raise money for our bleachers and for our swimming pool. On the other side, we really do want the community involved in our advisory committees. We
right.
want them as much as possible. When we open, we hope to have the Oakley Library in our school. Mm-hmm. We're going to have a child care facility that the parents can bring their children to. But we want the community to feel comfortable with the school and in the school, and to help us educate children. So if there's people out there who want to help mm-hmm. us in tutoring and et cetera, mm-hmm. that's important.
Mm-hmm. Sort of like parent volunteering and getting involved with the school.
Absolutely. The more the more involved they are, the more kids can get involved.
Right. Well, thank you both.
Thank you both
for being with
thank
us.
You.
Sounds exciting. I'm looking forward to Freedom being done sometime in January. This is Oakley Today.
Back again now with Athletic Director Dennis Henderson. Dennis, this is sure a beautiful spot here, isn't it?
Yeah, it's my favorite spot because you can see everything that really involves the athletic and physical education program from this area.
What kind of facilities are we going to be looking at down here eventually?
Well, if you start looking from the west, going from right to left, the first figuring you see there is the backstop for the one of the baseball diamonds. Right now it's set to be the junior varsity diamond, and when we get to the end of the pan you'll see the varsity diamond. But as you move in the background of that are the softball diamonds and the soccer field, and then moving slowly to the left, what'll come into view are practice fields, physical education fields, and even moving slower as you see the setting sun there in the west, coming into view are the boys' locker rooms, the wrestling room, and even closer you'll see the first set of goalposts and the track surrounding the football field. And as he moves continuing south, you'll see the unfinished portion of the gymnasium, and right adjacent to that are the girls' locker rooms and the weight room.
Are you in need of funding for some facilities at this point in time? I bet you are, huh?
Sure, in an election year we can always use funding. Right now our primary focus is raising funds for a pool, because the pool encompasses such a large number of not only students but the community and all different age levels. So we're really focusing on the pool. Is you can see we're minus bleachers, but we're working on a project for that right now. And just really getting more and more of the community knowledgeable on what we're doing athletic-wise here.
Okay. How are our facilities right now? A little stretched over at Liberty?
You know, it's we're using them. We're getting our taxpayers' money out of them, and there's really not an inch of ground that doesn't get used. But the Liberty people, Rod Beaver and Gene, and have been just so cooperative. Kay Axelgard and the Physical Education Department. That it's really hasn't been any type of a push pull or any animosity, whatever. It's been going real smooth.
Great. What sports are you running right now?
Right now, we're finishing off our fall sports. Our JV and freshman football have two games left. Volleyball will run for another approximately 2 weeks. Cross country has the league meet this next week, I believe, on the 8th. And tennis and soccer are finished. So we're all done with the fall sports almost.
Now, how do the big varsity sports like basketball, football, baseball, when are those going to come along?
Right now, we're planning on next year going into varsity sports with the majority of our offered athletic programs, with the exception of football. And what we have to do is we have to evaluate the type of turnout we get. If we have low numbers, then obviously we don't want to jump into a varsity program that wouldn't be competitive. And right now we're competing with a lot of the established schools in the league, so we're real comfortable with it. It's kind of a long-range vision, and we'll go from there.
Let me ask you a couple of questions now about just overall philosophy of the program you're going to run at Freedom High School. What are your basic goals with the kids in each one of the different athletic programs?
Well, to capsule it, we want to get as many kids involved as we can. The focus is participation, but also a participation in the classroom, and the two go so strongly hand in hand. The true meaning of the student athlete, the Liberty District has always focused on that, and we're not going to be any different. We want to make the programs competitive, because that is the nature of sports itself, yet giving an opportunity for a lot of kids to play.
Now, we've got a situation in society right now. Kids look for role models, right? And sports has classically been one of those things where you could learn about sportsmanship and respect for others, respect for institutions, leadership, the importance of hard work, discipline, and stuff like that. But yet you look at like professional sports figures today, and you don't get as much in terms of a role model as you might have gotten in the past. And some of that, of course, is the media, and the way the media spins different sporting events. But how much of the void can a high school sports program fill in that respect?
I think if you balance it out, and winning is a byproduct of all the hard work you get, and the I factor, and bring in more of the team factor, that's important. And I think bringing back people who have been part of this community and have had success and are good role models, bringing them back into the fold as far as possibly being coaches, hiring teachers that are finishing their credential that are from the area that the kids can kind of look up to, and get them away from a lot of the sensationalistic sports that you see.
Yeah, I see more of a grassroots approach.
Yeah, more of a grassroots, let's have some fun. It's going to be, get after it, but let's not worry about making our millions until we get our degrees.
More like, what can I do instead of watching somebody else do it?
Yeah, what can we do? Let's finish school and get our degrees, and then we'll see what happens after that.
How is the search for coaches going? What are you finding, and what are you looking for in a coach right now?
Well, the search for coaches is difficult. Although I think now more and more young people are getting into the area of physical education, and they're changing the area of physical education and expanding it. And coaching is just a very committed time. It's like Bill's music and Susan's cheerleading. The commitment is unbelievable for coaches, and it's hard to find people that are willing to commit. We're looking for energetic people that have the students' interest in mind first. And, it's difficult. But we're looking, and we're finding.
Okay. How about the competition question? How tough is it going to be compete in the different sports? Not only, you know, the big football and baseball programs, but, you know, the tennis and the soccer and the programs that are on their way up.
Competitiveness is sort of a natural thing. Some of these schools have a big jump on us.
Deer Valley, for instance, I noticed.
Well, Deer Valley is sort of a rookie programs. School like yeah. us. I think the population of the town gives them more students, whereas we're a little bit smaller. So we'll get there. We'll be competitive. We're competitive now. We'll be competitive. Competitiveness doesn't necessarily mean winning. Competitiveness means doing the best you can and taking the result, and winning is a result of being competitive. So Okay. Maybe the two can go hand in hand.
Okay. In one sentence, as a closeout here, what are you basically looking to do with this program here?
Make it competitive.
Oh,
two sentences. I just like to see a large number of kids come out and try, and whatever comes out of that, at least they can say that they made the effort to do so. And the more kids you get out, the more successful you're going to be. Wins and losses will happen, but let's get as many of them out as we can. Keep the grades up, get them out of high school, and then let whatever happens after that.
Dennis, thanks for being on the show. Thanks very much. We'll be back with some closing comments in just a moment. George Meyer and Associates, they're an architect firm from Oakland who have been hired by the county to do a design master plan for the new Oakley Library Community Center, gave us a call this week to inform us of a couple of public meetings where citizens in Oakley will be able to come and talk about what they'd like to see in the Library Community Center, which will be located right next to O'Hara Park School there on O'Hara Avenue. They're having two meetings, one on November the 16th, in the morning of November the 16th, a public meeting where you can come and express your wishes for a community center, and another one on the evening of December the 4th. That's two meetings you can go to meet with the associates and also the Oakley people who've been involved with them in putting the master plan together. And let your wishes known. If you need more information on that, call 625-2170. Also, the Oakley Incorporated people are still hard at work, and a petition will be going out probably at the end of November or the first part of December, asking citizens in town whether they'd like to see Oakley become a city. This would accompany the petition and proposal that goes to the local agency formation commission in the county, otherwise known as LAFCO, and a quarter of the registered voters in town have to sign that petition in order to make the proposal work at that level. Then, of course, about a year from now, if LAFCO approves that proposal, we could well be having elections here in Oakley on the cityhood issue. So if you're interested in that, on the first and third Thursday of each month at 3775 Main Street, Suite B, the Oakley Incorporating Committee meets, and you can certainly go by and see what's going on there. That's about it for us today. We'd like to thank Dennis Henderson, the athletic director at Freedom High School, Judy Reagan, the principal, Bryce Custodio, the assistant principal, Bill Golden, the music director, and also Susan Warren, the faculty advisor for the Freedom Cheerleaders, for coming by today. And we'd also like to thank, of course, as usual, Steve Nosenchuk, right behind the other side of the lens there, for helping us out so well today. And that's about going to do it for us. My name is Ron Borland.
And I'm Tinker Vanning. Thank you for watching This is Oakley.
And we'll see you next time. Thanks.